In this video, we're going to look at two-phase power distribution systems in more detail, and we'll compare them hypothetically with single-phase power distribution systems. By the way, when I say two-phase power here, I'm talking about power distribution systems that have the two phases 90 degrees apart. That's different from a typical split-phase power installation that you might find in North American homes. In that situation, the two phases that would typically come into a house are 180 degrees apart. That's a different scenario than what I'll be describing here when the two phases are only 90 degrees apart. As you might recall from the previous video, both phases are sinusoidal. The power in each of the individual phases is pulsed, but the power exiting the turbine when you add up the individual phase power is constant. That's one of the advantages of a two-phase power distribution system over a single-phase power distribution system when the power exiting the turbine is pulsed. It turns out that one of the advantages of a two-phase system over a single-phase system is that not as much copper is required in the distribution system. In order to analyze that, we're going to look at these four wires in more detail and think about how much current they need to carry. We have two hot wires for each of the two phases, and we have two neutral or return wires for each of the two phases as well. The hot wires carry current to the load, and the neutral wires carry current back from the load to the source. Of course, in any power distribution system, you also have earth grounds and earth wires for safety reasons. These should not ordinarily be carrying any current at all. I'll be leaving those off this schematic for our analysis here. Let's call the current in this phase one wire I1. The same current's going to flow in the neutral. Likewise, let's call this current corresponding to phase two, I2, and we would have that same current flowing through the neutral as well. I1 is V over R. The voltage for phase one is V0 sine omega t. I'm assuming that the coils on our turbine for these two phases are identical. I'm also assuming that the loads are balanced. In other words, the load resistances are equal to one another. This means that the amplitudes of our sine waves will also be the same. Using Ohm's law to find I2, we immediately see that the amplitudes of the currents are the same, but the currents are out of phase with one another by 90 degrees because one is a sine wave and one is cosine. In this configuration, the two-phase power distribution system doesn't have any advantages compared to the single-phase system. It's just two independent circuits. We're carrying twice the power to twice the loads, and the distribution system would use twice the copper. The size of a copper wire is directly related to the amount of current that would have to pass through that copper wire. If a wire has to carry more current, then it needs to be thicker and it uses more copper. So when I talk about saving copper, what I'm really talking about is the maximum current, or the RMS current, that would have to flow through a particular wire. Since the magnitude of I1 equals the magnitude of I2, it means that the RMS value for I1 would also equal the RMS value for I2. I'm transmitting twice the power, but I've used twice the number of cables. So where am I going with this? How is the two-phase distribution system going to be superior to the single-phase distribution system? Well, that advantage can come if I combine the two neutral wires into one. Our combined neutral wire will not change the RMS voltage across either of the two loads. It will also not change the amount of power flowing from the turbine. So we've not changed anything from the perspective of the turbine or the load. The question here is whether or not the same RMS value of the combined currents would flow through this single neutral wire. Let's use phasor form in order to combine this I1 and I2 together. Let's go ahead and graph these waveforms. We can see that the amplitude of the vector sum of I1 and I2 is not twice the amplitude of I1 or I2. If we look over here at our equation for I1, we see that the amplitude is just V0 divided by RL. Therefore, I1 RMS is just this amplitude divided by the square root of 2. Likewise for I2, it has the same RMS current as I1. However, if we look down here at our combined I1 plus I2, and I note the amplitude of the sine wave, if I divide this by the square root of 2, I then get the RMS current. Note that I1 plus I2 RMS is not I1 RMS plus I2 RMS because of this inequality. We're going to save copper. Let me show you. The metric that I'm going to use to compare these different power distribution systems is the amount of copper used divided by the amount of power that flows. In a single phase distribution system, we only have one current, and that current flows through two wires. The amount of copper needed to build the distribution system is related to the sum of the current flowing along these wires. Let's say that one unit of power is delivered to the resistor. We'll assume that we have the same amount of power delivered in the other systems as well. Let's now consider a two-phase system where we have four wires in the distribution network. We'll assume that we have the same resistive load and we have the same amplitude as we did in the single-phase system. In this two-phase system, we're going to have four wires. Each of the wires would be carrying the same amount of current as was the situation with the single-phase distribution case. Therefore, we have to cater for four units of copper, but we would be delivering two units of power. As you can see, the metric is identical as it was for the one-phase case. We don't have any advantage of the two-phase wiring system if we're using four wires. Let's now look at the three-wire scenario. In the three-wire system, we have two hots and a combined neutral. Since the RMS voltages across the load resistors are the same as they were in the other two scenarios here, I know that we still have two units of power delivered. The currents through the two hot wires have the same magnitude as they did with the four-wire system. The RMS current I2 is equal to the RMS current I1. So for these two wires, I can count two units. For our combined neutral wire, though, when I add I1 and I2, I'm not adding amplitudes. I need to take the vector sum. And as we saw in our calculation, the RMS value of the current was a square root of 2 factor different from that of I1 or I2 individually. Thus, in the same unit, this third wire carries square root of 2 times I1 rather than 2I1. Now that we've calculated our comparison metric, let's call the single phase situation our base case. It came out to be 2. For the two phase four wire system, it's also 2. The same as our base case, so we don't have any improvement if we move to a two-phase four-wire system beyond the improvements in the geometry of the turbine, for example. If we go to the two-phase three-wire case, though, we can see that the metric comes out to be 1.707. And remember, our metric is the amount of copper used per unit of power delivered. A smaller number is better because it means we can install less copper wiring, spending less money to do so if the number is smaller. Since this number came out to be 1.707, and that's a number smaller than 2, we can see that we saved money relative to our base case. This is why a two-phase power distribution system is better compared to the single-phase case. Although three-phase turns out to be even better than this, which I'll describe in the next video, two-phase power distributions have actually gone into operation before. This is a photo taken of the Adams Power Station at Niagara Falls. This particular power generation facility delivered two-phase power at 25 hertz. Two-phase power, where the two phases are 90 degrees apart from one another, is obsolete. In the next video, I'll describe why they're obsolete by showing you the three-phase case. Three-phase power allows even greater savings compared to the two-phase case. We have a whole series of professionally filmed and edited videos in order to help students learn the fundamentals of electricity. If you like watching this particular video, then you might like to check out some of our others too.